Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to tonight's event, which is part of the very first Canadian Mountain Network and University of Alberta Mountain Festival. I want to begin by acknowledging that we're located on Treaty 6 territory and our respect for the histories and languages and cultures of First Nations, Métis, Inuit, and all First Peoples of Canada. Their presence continues to enrich our community here at the University of Alberta. My name is David Hick, and I'm a professor in the Department of Biological Sciences here. I have two jobs this evening. The first is to introduce to you a little bit about the Canadian Mountain Network and the Mountain Festival and Mountain Studies at the University of Alberta. And then secondly, to introduce Marie-Eve Marchand, the MC for the rest of the evening. So what is the Canadian Mountain Network? It's an alliance of university professors and students, of governments, of First Nations, of businesses and community members that share a passion dedicated to the sustainability and understanding mountain places and mountain cultures and mountain environments, not just in Canada, but around the world. It was established earlier this year, and the Canadian Mountain Network has initiated and catalyzed and supported discussions about the future of mountain places in Canada and the various diverse environmental and social and economic changes that are taking place in mountains. And mountains are not just elevated places. We think of them in terms of the much larger landscapes that they influence as well. And for those of you that have been on Twitter this week, you probably have found it hard to ignore the hashtag Mountains Matter. And if you haven't seen that, it's a remarkable way of sort of tracking the various interests that people have in mountain places. And that's what we're trying to capture with the Mountain Network. The Canadian Mountain Network is hosted here at the University of Alberta with the support of the Faculty of Science. And over the next few months, one of the things we'll be focusing on is leading the preparation of a national Networks of Centers of Excellence proposal. These Networks of Centers of Excellence are large national collaborative research undertakings. They're one of the largest ways that we can sort of do multidisciplinary and collaborative research in Canada. And they focus on addressing Canada's social and economic challenges, and by accelerating the transfer of knowledge across sectors, and by training people. And so there will be an opportunity in the next year for us to promote mountains as a subject writ large that might be successful. We really want to turn the attention in Canada to mountain regions. And we're here this week because of International Mountain Day. And International Mountain Day has its roots back in 1992 during the United Nations Conference on Environment and Development in Rio de Janeiro. Now, the document that came out of that conference, Agenda 21, highlighted sustainable mountain development. And this brought increased attention to mountains globally. And some of you might have participated in a number of conferences during the International Year of Mountains in 2002 that were held in Banff and other places in Canada. But from that point onward, since 2003, December 11th has been designated as International Mountain Day. And each year, International Mountain Day has a different theme. In the past, previous themes have focused on freshwater, on peace, on biodiversity, on mountain farming, and on climate change. And around the world, various public events have been held to celebrate International Mountain Day. Book and poetry readings, thematic lectures, workshops, climbing competitions, things like that. The 2016 theme for International Mountain Day is Mountain Cultures, Celebrating Diversity and Strengthening Identity. We felt at the University of Alberta that it was time that we celebrated International Mountain Day a little bit more deliberately, that it was an opportunity to focus a little bit more attention on mountain places. At the university over the last few years, we've been developing a number of interdisciplinary courses that are focused on mountain studies, and I co-teach a number of these with colleagues from across campus, in the classroom and in the mountains. Most recently, we created a massive open online course, or a MOOC, called Mountains 101, and it will be offered for the first time starting January 9th, and these MOOCs are available to everyone, and they're free. And there's already a lot of interest. Over 6,000 people have signed up, which is kind of a bit daunting. But it's been really fun creating this course because we've had so many partners from outside of the university, including Parks Canada and Travel Alberta and the Alpine Club of Canada and others. Now, the Mountain Festival this week has all sorts of fantastic events, and I encourage you to check out the full schedule if you got a copy of the program here, and everything is online at internationalmountainday.ca. And yesterday, there was a live stream event from Banff and Jasper and Haines Junction in the Yukon. And just to give you a taste of that, there's a short highlight reel or mashup that we're going to play right now.
Welcome to the Canadian Mountain Network's first ever International Mountain Day live stream.
Jasper is a beautiful place to come out and experience the mountains.
The United Nations first declared International Mountain Day in 2003. And ever since, on December 11th, communities from around the world come together to celebrate and bring awareness to the world's mountain environments and the people and cultures that inhabit them. Let's check in now with some webcams. Here's a shot from Banff. This is in the west end of Glacier National Park right now. There's Lake Louise. There are many skiers that are heading out, about to enjoy the slope. This is Marmot Basin. Some hungry skiers heading in to the lodge. We're going to head to Haines Junction now.
You see the St. Elias Range, which is the front range of the largest non-polar ice cap in the world.
Here we are inside of the St. Elias Convention Center.
We're going to be heading down to Banff, to the White Museum Archives and Library. As you can see, some gorgeous photos taken by Bert. And Brittany, it makes me think, like, imagine Instagram had been around at that time. The mountains would have been way more populated, like, right away. They're just so gorgeous. We're going to be heading to the Jasper Public Library, where I see Greg Deagle with the Jasper Artists Guild.
We are a nonprofit visual arts group centered here in Jasper. We've been together for 15 years. We have operated out of a real eclectic set of different venues.
Thank you so much for joining us today, for hearing stories from Haines Junction, from Jasper, from Banff. We've been able to see some webcams from around BC, Alberta, and the Yukon. And thank you for hopefully engaging at hashtag Mountains Matter on Twitter. If you're using it, it works on Instagram as well. And if you want any more information about the upcoming International Mountain Day Festival that is happening at the University of Alberta this week, you can always head to internationalmountainday.ca for more information. And of course, for links to all sorts of wonderful projects that we've talked about today on the broadcast. So thank you so much for joining me and have a fantastic International Mountain Day.
Right now, I'd like to introduce the MC for the rest of the evening. Marie-Ève Marchand is the coordinator of Bison Belong. Marie-Ève is from Lac-Saint-Jean, Quebec, but lives in Banff now. She started her conservation work with CPAWS in Quebec in 2004 and became a CPAWS National Trustee in 2009. And she now chairs the National Conservation Committee. She's also a member of the World Commission on Protected Areas. And in 2009, she began to get involved in the campaign to support reintroduction efforts to bring plains bison back to Banff National Park. And that is what this evening is all about. So without further ado, Maria.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming in this beautiful, snowy, cold Monday. We'll be talking about bison, buffalo, Banff National Park, and what's coming up in weeks from now. So the evening will be, I want to first say thank you to David, thank you to the Canadian Mountain Network, thank you to the Eleanor Luxton Foundation, who's been allowing so many things to happen, and you'll see, you're here for a great treat. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Karsten Heuer. I see he's the project manager for the bison reintroduction in Banff National Park. Karsten has been also working in national parks for over 20 years. been in the North, been in Jasper, been in Banff, but he also took many leaves of absence, and you might know him for being caribou. He also worked for the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative. So I would like, without further ado, to introduce Karsten.
And I think my role here tonight is really to tell you some of the specifics about the exciting project to try to bring bison back to Banff National Park. They've been gone for about 140 years. But I think it's also to just set up the panel as well for you to get some ideas in your head about what you want to explore, not just about bison reintroduction in Banff, but I think more importantly, just about bison conservation and this much larger effort to actually restore this super important species on the landscape. And Banff is merely one example of where it's trying to happen here in the next little while. You might say, well, why? Why would you even try in Banff? The first reason is there's a lot of evidence that bison did exist there. Again, they disappeared about 140 years ago, but every time there's an excavation, even in the town of Banff, they're always unearthing bison bones, bison skulls. And we've also done some archaeological digs in other parts of the park, and they're prevalent everywhere, plains bison. Explorer records in the late 1700s, bison were actually the second most prevalent ungulate, hoofed mammal, after bighorn sheep. The world as we know it today, with, you know, we see deer and elk when we go through Banff, it's not actually representative of what was once there. So again, we're just seeing a snapshot in time. And Parks Canada, one of its big roles is to restore the ecological web of life in these areas that are representative of what they might have been without human intervention, or modern human intervention, certainly industrial intervention. And bison play a really important ecological role that's been missing for 140 years, everything from the kind of grazing they do, the way they actually influence forest fires across the landscape, the kind of microhabitats they create through their wallowing behavior for things like amphibians, the importance of their fur for birds, their dung for certain insect communities, and obviously the amount of protein that's there in one big, 2,000 plus pound package for predators and scavengers as well. And all that's been missing for 140 years. So again, Parks Canada is really interested in trying to restore the larger ecosystem, and obviously that involves bringing back missing elements, of which bison are huge. And again, our mandate as an agency, one of our primary mandates is to manage these areas for what we call ecological integrity. And that really does involve bringing back the major players. Our project, again, they've been missing for 140 years, and our approach is to start small and kind of learn as we go along. We're hoping to start very soon here. Mary Ev was right, literally in a number of weeks now, with a project that would then, the first phase would be a 5-year time frame where we would assess as we went along on how well it's going of trying to bring back this large mammal to this landscape. And then we've chosen to start in a remote area of Banff National Park. It's literally 2 days walk or ski from the nearest road accessible trailhead. And that's logistically complex for us starting there. But actually we thought it's really important rather than starting right in the heart of the Bow Valley, for instance, where we have 4 million visitors a year. So this is just an overview. You can see where we are there today up in Edmonton. And this is Banff National Park with this black and white line around it, and this dark green blob is the reintroduction zone. So here's the Bow Valley and the Trans-Canada Highway. There's the town of Banff. This is the forestry trunk road. So again, this is a gravel road going to a government-owned horse ranch here, but really it's quite remote. There's not a lot of there's no road access into the actual area. And then we also mapped, it's important to think about what's nearby. These are the westernmost farms and ranches, these dots, and then these are the nearest grazing allotments on provincial land. So what you can actually see is this band of provincial land between grazing allotments and then private land is actually quite large. It's much larger than say, Prince Albert National Park in Saskatchewan, where you already have bison, and as soon as they leave the park, they're on private land. Similar to Elk Island, it's surrounded by private land. We actually have a pretty nice buffer through those two things happening there in terms of seasonal grazing allotments and private land. And then a lot of you might think, wow, you know, I've been to Banff and there's glaciers and big Rocky Mountains. But actually the area where we're starting is a little bit to the north and east, and it's quite a different geoclimatic zone. It's influenced a lot more by Chinook events in the winter. It's a lot drier and it's a lot grassier, as you can see. This is the heart of the reintroduction zone, the Panther River Valley. And you can also see, like, these recent forest fires here. It's an area that we've actually been able to restore the natural fire regime, which is not, the Bow Valley isn't the same case. We actually have a lot more open areas and a lot of pretty great bison habitat. This is a photo from the ground in October. And again, you can see it's quite grassy, and we've actually done habitat analyses that suggest that we could actually have hundreds, if not 1,000 bison there year round, if you're just thinking about forage alone. So that doesn't take a bunch of other attributes into account. So, but it's possible to have bison back there in addition to the archaeological evidence. I just want to go through quickly just some of the details of the project. I thought I'd talk about the three phases. The first one, translocation, this coming February, if all goes according to plan, then we're planning to hold them for a period of time for 16 months to get them used to the area, and that by far is our biggest challenge, is trying to ensure and do everything possible to get these animals to bond to that place as their new home, as with any reintroduction. And then there'll be a free roaming phase that would then end that 5-year project, where we would then reassess and see whether longer term bison restoration in the area is feasible. So I just want to go through each of those three very quickly. The translocation, we're fortunate that within Parks Canada Agency, right next to Edmonton here, we have Elk Island National Park, which has actually been the source population for over 25 bison translocations around the world. And it's been found to be brucellosis and tuberculosis free since the 1970s, tested by the Canadian Food Inspection Agency every 2 years, which is a huge thing, because in Wood Buffalo National Park up north, you do have diseased animals there, and down in Yellowstone you have diseased animals there. But what we have here in Elk Island, through the good management by Parks Canada and particularly the staff in Elk Island, has been this repository of genetically pure and brucellosis and tuberculosis free bison, by which we can seed populations around the world. There's been some Elk Island bison that have gone to Alaska recently. There's others that have gone as far afield as Russia. And of course, in Grasslands National Park in southern Saskatchewan, reintroduction was done in 2005, and now those original 50 animals number over 400. So lots of success in lots of areas from having the animals come from Elk Island. Again, we're starting small. We're only gonna start with 16 animals, but we want to actually sort of start with those animals loaded, if you were. We want to have 12 of the young females pregnant with calves, and then 4 young bulls. And then we've been told by people who ranch bison domestically, as well as a number of reintroduction experts, the best thing we can do is actually have them calve in that new place to start to get them to think about that as home. And obviously the new calves being born are going to consider it home as well. So we're actually targeting those young pregnant animals to start, and then we're actually going to hold them long enough for them to calve twice. So again, that calving period. And then we're going to obviously disease, despite the tuberculosis and brucellosis free status of Elk Island, we still are taking a number of precautions along the way to absolutely be sure that we won't be introducing disease through this project. That includes a quarantine to begin. Then once the animals come from Elk Island, it's gonna be a pretty interesting day for those animals. They're gonna be loaded in Elk Island, driven through the night to a place called the Yaha Tinda Ranch, Government Horse Ranch, which is one of the nearest roads, or it is where the nearest road gets to, but then that road ends, And we're literally going to have to lift these guys in crates where they're about four to a crate underneath a helicopter to get them into the reintroduction paddock, if you will. Well, they'll start 25 kilometers away from the nearest road. We started getting that pasture system ready this past summer. Well, we have the benefit of there's an existing old warden cabin there from the 1950s. So we have a nice infrastructure base, and we actually converted an existing pasture for the park warden's horses into a fence that looks a lot more like the one that surrounds Elk Island, and this is where we're going to start. It's about 45 acres in size. For those 16 months, we'll have people working there in pairs, a mix of staff teamed up with volunteers, and then we're going to hold the animals so they calve twice. And then again, that's one of our greatest challenges, which is to get them to bond to their new home. And then we're also going to be teaching them a few things in those initial months that hopefully will stick with them when they do become free roaming. The one thing that we're going to try and teach them is respect for this kind of a fence, which they may encounter once they're released in some key pinch points where they could leave the reintroduction zone. So this is a cross fence in that soft release pasture. So we're going to teach them respect for that before they get released. And then we are also going to use a little bit of stockmanship to get them used to being herded, which on the landscape, we're going to use a low stress stockmanship technique to help them sort of discover and keep within the larger 1200 square kilometer reintroduction zone. Again, toward that end of getting them bonded to this new place as their new home. And so a little bit more heavy-handed on the front end for the first few years, but with the interest of actually having it work so that generations from now we have free-roaming, fully wild bison on this landscape. Then we go to the free-roaming phase, and again, to reach this objective of getting them to bond to the place, we have a few different tools we're going to be using. We're going to subdivide the reintroduction zone into management zones where there's different actions on our behalf depending where the bison are, which I'll get into in a minute. We have a few select areas where we're going to be using wildlife permeable fences that can get into a mode where they hold back the bison if the bison are getting close to where they might exit the reintroduction zone. And then we're already started on some habitat enhancement. So just to zoom in on that green blob of the 1,200 square kilometer reintroduction zone, which is about one-fifth the entire size of Banff National Park, we've divided it into three different zones, the green being the core reintroduction zone, and that's, you saw the picture from the air that I showed early on in that, and then the blue areas are areas they can expand into in the first couple of years, and the yellow area, the donut, outer donut, is what we call a hazing zone, where they'll be encouraged through stockmanship techniques to actually go back into the green and blue areas in those initial years, so again, to help them bond to that new area. And then the little red slashes are little points, little sections of that wildlife permeable fencing that I'll talk a little bit more about. And right in the middle, you can't see it too well, but this green dot with a black dot in it is that soft release pasture. So it's sort of the center of the bullseye. And you can imagine we're gonna be slowly expanding their range, almost like a rancher might expand or move a herd of animals around different pasture systems. And we really have the benefit that the containment happens mostly naturally by rock ridges in that environment, and it actually subdivides it almost into a natural pasture system. So we'll gradually be increasing the pasture for them as we go along. We've zoomed out a bit now, and we also have been, for the initial part of the first 5 years, we actually don't want them in parts of the park. So we actually have surrounded that hazing zone with a recapture zone in the red crosshatched area, where if they go into there, we'll physically be trying to either get them back in the hazing zone and then eventually into those green and blue zones, or we might actually have to move them out towards the nearest road, set up a mobile capture pen and recapture them and drive them all the way around to the Aha Tinder Ranch. And you can actually back to the, you can get a trailer into the very edge of the range, the reintroduction zone, and start again. Hopefully that doesn't happen, but that's our contingency if it does. And you'll notice there's no red crosshatch zone on the provincial side. And it's been a really interesting part of this project. It's been working with the province of Alberta, where bison currently are not classified as wildlife, and trying to come up with a strategy for what we're going to do across this shared boundary. And so we've been respecting the province's position up until now that the bison would have actually no status, neither as livestock or wildlife. They aren't considered wildlife currently under the Alberta Wildlife Act. But we're waiting. We can't draw that red crosshatched area in there, so that's an active conversation we're in with the province on what's the recapture zone on the provincial side, and how much time do we have to resolve the situation if bison are out there. Now, a really interesting thing is there's lots of calls, and I'm sure it's going to come up in our panel discussions, from lots of different places for the province to consider bison as a wildlife species. And then they're also undergoing a review of their status in the province of Alberta right now as well. So it's a really interesting dynamic time for the status of bison in this province. So just a little bit on the fencing. We did a ton of testing of these different fence types and over the last year and a half, and we actually found a design that was recommended wasn't permeable enough for our standards, Parks Canada standards, for other wildlife like elk and sheep to get through. So we actually had to go towards an adjustable design. And so it'll go from a sort of 5-wire, 5-foot-high fence that can, most of the time, the default mode will be, those wires will be bundled into 2 groups that would actually form less of a barrier than your typical rancher 3-wire barbed wire fence you see on the side of the highway. But through this simple staple lock, double staple cotter pin system, you can expand those out to be a 5-wire system again. So it's a bison holding mode or a wildlife permeable mode. And that adjustability, that dual design is the way we've sort of met this very difficult to achieve objective of how are you gonna hold back bison sometimes with a fence that's permeable to wildlife the rest of the time. And we've done a bunch of testing on that as well with remote cameras, and we're pretty confident that that's great for elk to get over, and deer and bighorn sheep to get under, and the large carnivores, very small sample sizes we've had so far, but no indications that that forms a barrier for them as well. The last piece, the habitat enhancement, we've been doing a bunch of prescribed burning. Particularly meadow burning. Bison really respond to burned over areas for the succulent growth that comes up afterwards. We can use it as a tool to actually steer them a little bit around the landscape. And this is not a creation of Parks Canada's. This is by all the evidence that we see archaeologically and with fire histories and lightning patterns. This actually was done on the eastern slopes by First Nations long before Parks Canada even existed. So, this is a really neat project for how it's actually some of our management techniques and approaches today are actually old management techniques and approaches, if you will. So we have specific targets there, and we're well on the road to reaching those targets. And then just because of the concern around disease, we're committing to actually testing any bison in those first 5 years that does die, regardless of the source of mortality, to doing tests for disease. And we have committed to people like the Canadian Cattlemen's Association and Alberta Agriculture because of their concern that if we, in the very unlikely event that we did detect tuberculosis or brucellosis, we would actually cull that herd. So that wouldn't be a very good development in the first 5 years, but we're pretty confident that isn't gonna happen. So just in summary, it's a start small, go slow, 5-year pilot. We have a whole bunch of performance measures for the project that we will be measuring as we go along and to assess it in 5 years. And then if we determine after 5 years that, you know what, longer term bison restoration in the area is not feasible, then we've committed to removing the animals and the fences. And if the answer is, you know what, it looks pretty promising, then our commitment is to develop a management plan where we set population targets and a bunch of other parameters as well. What's the definition of success from Parks Canada perspective? It's definitely ecological restoration. So a breeding population of wild bison back in that area. The cultural reconnection component is huge, and it's been a real pleasure working on this project with a lot of Treaty 7 First Nations that have some of their traditional range in our traditional territories in the park. They're really, really excited about this project and have been involved, and we're going to hear more about that directly from some of those folks on the panel. And it's been a real honor for me to be working with those people. And then, you know, for everybody, every Canadian, the Parks Canada is working on your behalf. And it's been so neat for me on this project to just see how captivated people get when you talk about trying to bring back Canada's largest mammal back into an area where it's been missing for 140 years. This is an animal that gets our attention, and it's been really neat to see how inspired and excited people are. We're just in the final phases of a public review period for our environmental assessment for the project. If we get a positive determination from my big boss, the superintendent, then we'll proceed with beginning the translocation in just a little over a month here in February 2017. Thank you.
Thank you, Karsten. And I hope that little glimpse of what's coming in will be way more enhanced with, I would like to invite everyone on this panel to join me. Before I introduce everyone, Karsten talked about how amazing it is to bring back the bison or the buffalo. I want to say I will use bison and buffalo quite like interchangeably while I'm being talking. So if I talk about bison for me, I talk about this furry animals. I talk about the actual physical being. But when I talk about buffalo, I kind of talk more of the cultural perspective. I talk about the larger than life, that our relationship with all the other beings. Bear with me when I say, because you'll see buffalo, bison all the time, and they are quite equal. It really depends where you want to be. So we'll be talking buffalo, we'll be talking bison, and I can now have the pleasure to introduce my amazing friends and colleagues. I will start at the end of the table. So William Snow. William is from the Stoney Nakoda Nation. So if anyone drives from Calgary to Banff, you've passed through the reserve. And William is both, is a dual citizen, actually, it's very interesting, from the Stoney Nakoda, but also with the Yuma Quechuan in the United States. Bill has been working on consultation with First Nations for quite a long time. He's the consultation manager for the Tribal Council of the Stoney Nakoda. He's been working on issues regarding the either land management, it's been industrial resource project management, traditional lands, and he's also a dear friend, and he's very, very care about the buffalo, and he's here, you'll see, he has a deep history in the bison and long time. And beside Bill is Tanya. Tanya is here teaching at the University of Alberta. She's a member of Carry-the-Kettle, so in southern Saskatchewan, First Nation. She's an artist. She's the associate professor, as I say. She is part of the art and design in the Faculty of Native Studies here in Edmonton. She's an amazing artist. And film, photography, print, drawing, fibers. Her art has been exhibited in many museums here in Canada at the Glambo, but also at the Oxford University of Pitt's River Museum in Moscow. And she's the one who drew that beautiful design on the Buffalo Treaty. And we'll be talking about the Buffalo Treaty, but on the way out, there's a banner, and the Buffalo Treaty is there. And that design of the buffalo, that's hers. So welcome, Tanya. Beside Tanya, we have our distinguished Dr. Leroy Little Bear. Leroy is part of the Blood Indian Reserve, is an eminent scholar. He is one of the first Indigenous persons who graduated from the University of Lethbridge yesterday. He's been a professor, recipient of numerous Aboriginal Award and Award. He has been named a few weeks ago by the left-handed governors of Alberta. And he's also written many articles, published many books on science, philosophy, law, has a law degree of the University of Utah. It's just an elder that we should all have, and I'm really grateful to have you and Amethyst in our life. Beside, we have Dale Kirkland, superintendent of Elk Island National Park. Who's been to Elk Island? Raise of hand. We're in a good crowd. So Dell is newly moved about months ago to Elk Allen. And before being in Elk Allen, he's been with Transport Canada. And it's very interesting because he was not only with Transport Canada, but he was also the manager for the Churchill Airport in Manitoba. So he kind of moved from polar bear to bison. And we'll be talking about that. Beside Dell, we have Harvey Locke. Harvey is the co-founder and strategic advisor for the Yellowstone to Yukon Conservation Initiative. He's also a trustee with the Eleanor Luxton Historical Foundation. Harvey is a photographer, a writer, my beautiful husband, received numerous prizes and is a member of the IUCN committee. He received the G.B. Arkin Award for Conservation from CEPAS a few years ago. He also received the Queen Elizabeth, his Golden Leaf Award, is the Fred Packard International Awards on his work on national parks and conservation. And he also wrote and published with Dr. Leroy Wilbur an amazing book that we'll be talking about it. And we brought some copy for you because it's newly published that you can have access, and we brought them for you. Beside Harvey, we have Dr. Tasha Hubbard. Dr. Tasha Hubbard is at the University of Saskatchewan in Saskatoon. She flew for you this morning. She's turning back for a meeting tomorrow at lunch. So we're very grateful to have Tasha with us. Tasha is a filmmaker. She is also an artist. She is her first movie, Two Worlds Colliding, won the Jiminy Awards in 2005. She's also worked on a really interesting animations movie on the Buffalo Calling, and we'll be talking more about this. She is currently working on her film project about the 60s scoop, and she's really like in edition mode right now, and that's her holiday vacation. And she's also spent most of her research on indigenous film and the relationship with indigenous people in Buffalo. She has years of knowledge and research. And she's Cree from the Pivikasis Nation in Saskatchewan. And we have Karsten. So what we have today with us is like an amazing round of people coming from all across the landscape. And none of you know them all. How are we going to work? I have one question that's very simple that I'm going to ask all of them to answer. And then from there, I have specific questions to kind of tread a narrative of Buffalo as we move through the landscape before we get your questions. My first one is, why is Buffalo important to you? And I will ask any one of you and get all your information. Why is it important? Why do you care? Why should we care about Buffalo?
I grew up outside of my culture, and I was adopted as a baby into a farming family in southern Saskatchewan. And I found my family when I was 16. And my parents, my dad was a lawyer, my mom's a writer, and they shared with me the history of our people in this country and in this land, and would talk a lot about things like the Indian Act and residential school and other things that resulted in our oppression. And then in 2005, I read an article about the drastic loss of the buffalo, and it just struck me, and I remember reading it and feeling just immense grief and wondering, like, how did this affect us? How did it affect us when we'd had a relationship with this animal for so long, for, you know, as many years as you can never count? What is that like to lose that? And that just became a driving force for me, both in my film work, but also in my research when I decided to pursue academia. For me as an Indigenous person, it's around working through my film work and other work to understand that relationship better, to use film as a medium to share that importance. Because I think a lot of times everyone gets taught that the buffalo were a food source, that they were a material sense of being able to live. Absolutely, we depended on the buffalo so much, but it was more than that, and that's my work, is what is that kinship relationship that we had and continue to have with buffalo? How does that show itself? Where is that relationship strong, and how can it be shared within our communities, but also as a different way for everyone to understand how we connect to the land, how we live here in relation to other beings, to other nations that live here with us, not just human beings, but more than human beings. So that's why it's important to me. It teaches me how to live well here in this territory, in my people's territory.
Welcome to the mountain. Maria, you ask, why is the buffalo important to us and to me? Let me put it this way. In the same way, something you can all relate to. If we were to take all your iPhone and smartphones away from you, what would happen? Can you live without them? For Christians, if we were to close all the churches, how long would Christianity last? What would that do to society as a whole? That's the role that the buffalo played in Plains Indian culture. It was keystone. It was one of the foundational bases of the very culture that our people build itself around this animal. Some of our sacred societies, beliefs, stories, songs, and so on were all around the buffalo. And its disappearance really starts to ask those questions that I was asking you about your iPhones and smartphones or closing all the churches down. That's the importance of the buffalo. Now, and probably more importantly, is the fact that it's a relationship. We are the buffalo, and the buffalo is us. It's not just that animal. The buffalo has a whole relational network. We humans are only one part of it. But the buffalo has a web of relationships with other animals, with the environment, the plant life, and so on. The buffalo is not just itself, that animal. It is that whole web of relationships. That's why the buffalo is important to our people.
I had brought an image. There was a piece that was in the Glenbow Museum circa 1200. It's a beautiful piece. You look back at it and think, oh my goodness, this long ago that people were giving acknowledgement and respect to the buffalo. To know that this is something that was always there, that we can go back that far and revere the buffalo. I think by taking a look at the buffalo in the museum, seeing it on display, it gives us imagination. We are in a point right now where we're looking at imagining, and I think everyone's at this point where we're going, oh, I wonder what it'd be like. What would happen when the buffalo comes like this? And what happens if they do this? And what happens when they do that? And it means different things to different people. As an artist, you know, when I look at this piece up here, I think about what it is in our imagination. How far can imagination go? In doing that drawing, I was for the treaty, I was so excited and felt it was so important to do that drawing. It was kind of short notice that I got asked to do it, but that made it so much urgent. And I've been reluctant to draw the buffalo or do anything because it is so sacred. I would want to be very careful about how I would look at the buffalo spirit and what does it mean. So I think that imagination belongs to everybody, and I can see it in other people's eyes and in their disciplines and what they're doing, and I'm just in awe at imagination.
I think for myself, it has been important culturally for our nation and for many other First Nations for many years. Being able to take part in the bison reintroduction ceremony this past summer, involving our ceremonial people, our elders, and reestablishing that relationship and welcoming buffalo back to the Banff National Park was a very important aspect of this whole introduction project. It is creating new relationships within our traditional societies. The other important piece here, I think that's important for the university, is that we're able to talk a little bit more constructively around the use of traditional knowledge in a wide number of areas, and bringing that part of the discussion to whether we're talking about studies on wildlife species or studies on habitat, all of the areas that traditional knowledge touches on. I think that's important for the university to acknowledge and to build on. And certainly part of the work that we're doing now with Canadian Mountain Network, the work that we've done with the MOOC involving the traditional knowledge aspect in the online course that's coming up in January. So I think this is a needed area. It's a growing trend, and we need to be including this type of traditional knowledge within the formal education process. And so it's important for all those reasons, for the continuance of culture, but also in helping us to reestablish our relationships with the land, which is ultimately based on ceremony.
On behalf of Elk Island National Park, our park has made lasting contributions to bison conservation through our management, through our expertise for over a century. Karsten made reference to Elk Island National Park being a seed herd. And I want to emphasize that Elk Island National Park is the priority conservation bison herd for domestic and international bison initiatives. It's a nursery herd for the world at Elk Island National Park. Working closely with our friends in Banff National Park, working closely with our stakeholders and our indigenous partners, Elk Island National Park is honored, very honored that we can contribute the 16 plains bison to Banff to assist in the reestablishment of this iconic, majestic animal in this region, and to, if I could steal words, to support the web of relationships in that area.
For me, bison are really important because I grew up hearing stories about them when they were numbering in the millions in this landscape. So my great-great-grandparents came into southern Alberta in the 1870s from Montana. There was a buffalo herd in Morley, where Bill lives, when they set up the mission there, the McDougall Mission. There was a time they had to stop a steamboat for 7 hours for a buffalo herd to cross the Missouri in front of them. That was 140 years ago. My mother knew the people who had that experience. And then we killed them all, except for somewhere between 64 and a couple hundred. But we did save them, and we saved them from extinction, but we didn't put them back in the landscape as a living force. The opportunity to put them back, for me, is for us to redeem ourselves for that massive slaughter that we did 140 years ago when we turned the soil upside down, we put the Indians on reserves, and we killed off almost all the buffalo. And putting them back, for me, is to restore something that we did wrong and making it right. And to put it back in our most famous national park, one of the great icons of conservation in the world, is, I think, for us Canadians, a great thing for us to do. That's why I'm so keen on it.
For me, it's just a job. I grew up in Calgary. My parents immigrated from Germany. They were nuts about wild places, and I had the good fortune to every weekend they would drag us out to the mountains, and we'd go through that landscape driving back and forth through that was filled with bison. And I knew that from stories I'd been reading, from specials I'd seen on TV and so on. And I just had a childhood fascination with wild animals, particularly big herds, and the concept of throngs of them moving through a landscape where they would stop a steamboat for a day was just really, really captivating to me. So much so that in my career with Parks Canada, I actually sought a place where you could still experience that today in northern Canada, in the Yukon, and with caribou herds. And I found myself working in a place called Avavik National Park, which the Nuvialawit translation is the place where life begins. And I was so captivated with the porcupine caribou herd there, which now numbers 250,000 animals, that I actually took a leave of absence, and their calving grounds are threatened by oil and gas development on the Alaskan side. They move across the boundary. So my wife and I set off to try to bring their voice to that long-standing debate about whether or not their calving grounds should get developed for oil and gas. And we actually did it in a way that we thought maybe their voice could be heard, the caribou's point of view could come to the table. And we thought the value of that place is in everything they go through to get there and back again every year in their migration. So my wife Leanne and I followed that migration for 5 months on foot and by ski. And this is a complete wilderness area, no roads, no pipelines for 5 months. My training as a scientist, my upbringing as a conventional Western participant in Canadian urban society, all that just fell to the wayside. And over the course of those 5 months, Leanne and I started to experience the land actually, and the caribou themselves actually speaking through us in ways that we were having dreams that told us where to find them when we lost them. We were tapping into sounds that they made in the sort of infrasonic realm on the edge of human hearing to actually inform how to find them when we lost them. And there was just an effortlessness to the way that we actually moved with these animals over the course of those 5 months that couldn't be explained in anything I'd learned in my previous life. I know what is possible in terms of deep connection with big, big animals and herd animals. For me, the prospect of starting that again, bringing that back to a landscape where I truly considered my home landscape, is just it's an amazing opportunity. It's a pleasure to and a thrill to be trying to work on it, and to be working on it not just in isolation as a person or even within an agency, but with the sort of people that you're hearing from on this panel today.
Thank you all. I wanted to start like that so you get a sense of who we're you're talking with and we're in a conversation. What we're doing tonight and what we've been doing and what the bison are doing, we are all dreaming about the future, imagination, recreating a place of new relationship, not only with us and among us, but with this landscape, with all the other beings. And this buffalo is a symbol, is a portal to something else. And that's what we're really talking about, that we invite you today to just join that beautiful dream of where we could be. By bringing the bison back where you heard about it, its relationship, it's the land, it's the traditional knowledge, it's what it comes from the ground, but it's also, it's a keystone that's missing among the species. It's a place of change. To better understand that, I have a series of questions that hopefully will work it through everyone's here on the table, because they all have a little chapters to that story that they're bringing to you. And they're really like all here because there's special knowledge that they hold that I want them to share. So I'm hoping that through my question, I will be able to open those doors for you to better understand that it's not about the reversible, maybe. It's not about the 16 animals. This is something much bigger. 2017 is Canada 150th anniversary. It's time to reimagine. It's time to know where we're going, and this is part of it. So you're all part of this new dreams with us. So I want to start with, because we've been mentioning, and Harvey, you kind of touched base on it, but let's go back. 150 years, let's go back 180 years. Let's go back when we had 30 to 60 million hoofs on the ground, roaming together in different herds, coming into the landscape to seasonal migration. But what did happen? How did it happen? And how did we move from so quickly from a near massive extension to actually what we're talking about, it's ecological restoration. It's something more than beautiful, yummy bison burger. And Karsten touched a bit on it about not being a wildlife. So Harvey, the Luxton Foundation published a book, The Last of the Buffalo, Return to the Wild. And I would really like you, if you could explain a little bit more, which it's only going to be a glimpse, because please do buy the book. There's also a really, it's four chapters, one on the Buffalo Treaty that Leroy Little Bear wrote. There's one chapter by Dr. George Culpit of the University of Calgary on the history of the bison. There's a great chapter about the nature of conservation with Harvey Dale Talkmore, and there's one from Jennifer Rutker of the White Museum in Banff about the archives. So really, like, don't go out. It's hard to find again, and you have a better deal if you buy it with us today. So just saying. Harvey.
So what we tried to do with this book, The Last of the Buffalo, Return to the Wild, is tell the story of the bison's once abundance, profound cultural importance, as described by Leroy, chronicling the role of the buffalo or bison through history of conservation, the seminal role that Elk Island National Park played in conserving the species from near extinction, the now forgotten story of how Banff National Park was profoundly engaged in keeping the buffalo from going extinct. And we got these historical photographs in the back, which are actually from the roundup of the Pablo Allard buffalo herd when it was rounded up in Montana, and a fellow named Norman Luxton from Banff took large format photographs of it and published a booklet at the time, which we've reproduced here. And these are the animals actually you can go to Elk Island and see. But this is where they came from, this famous Pablo Allard buffalo herd. And we have Norman Luxton's account of what the roundup was like. And it's quite fascinating. It was the first time anybody had ever rounded up a wild buffalo animal. So this is a heck of a story, and it was followed heavily in the North American news at the time, but a little bit lost to our memory, so we brought it back. And these original documents and photos are all in the White Museum of the Canadian Rockies, and we wanted to bring them to life. So that's the story of the book. And just to touch on what George Culpitz, the historian, talks about is the disappearance of the buffalo occurred from south to north through different mechanisms. There's kind of a story we have that it happened from east to west, but it's actually a pretty complex story that occurred over the course of the 19th century. But bottom line is we went from something like 30 to 50 million animals in 1800 to we know of at 64 that survived, maybe a few more than that. It's an astonishing tale of wanton destruction. And then what happened in about 30 years ago, people started talking about restoring native species and restoring native ecology to landscapes with the emergence of conservation biology and their role as an ecological process, this relationship that Leroy talked about. And of course, very famously in Yellowstone Park in the mid-1990s, they took wolves from Alberta and British Columbia and put them back in Yellowstone. And it occurred to me that it would be pretty interesting for us to put buffalo back in Banff Park, too. And I wasn't alone in that thought process. And so for about 20 years, we've been thinking about whether we could put the animals back. And most people don't know that the elk you see when you go to the mountains were reintroduced from Yellowstone in 1917. They actually were extinct in our mountain parks, but brought back. So this idea of restoring animals has a long, deep history. But the idea of restoring them as an ecological process is actually a fairly new idea, and how they play this keystone role in the landscape. And I'm going to shout out that Wes Olson, who's in the audience up back here, has handled more bison reintroductions and moved more animals around the world than anybody else alive. And we know how to do this. It's pretty exciting that we can do it. And so anyway, we've tried in this book to give you the story of all of that in some readable and visually interesting way.
Thanks, Harvey. And it's already a glimpse because I have like so many people. And from there, I think that Dale, you're managing Elk Island. Elk Island is really like people have been there, as we can have asked in the audience. You know, it's fence. But what it's really, I just want to talk a little bit more. And we talk about West and the 30 up to Russia. Actually, Elk Island is really part of restoring bison into their natural habitat. So imagine the map, 30 to 60 million, gone. mainly the few last bison, those 64, all being kept in fence area, little tiny corner. What we're imagining now is, what about they play their full role and we get them out of the fence? So, as Elk Island, can you describe a little bit of the process? How do you do, how you contribute with partnership to bring bison to their natural habitat?
How we do that? Elk Island National Park is the only fenced national park across the network. The fence is meant to keep the bison in, and it's done its job doing so. Since the park was formed in 1913 officially as a national park, Elk Island National Park, we've provided approximately 2,500 plains bison and wood bison, 2,500 in a century, to domestic conservation initiatives in other places in Alberta, Saskatchewan, BC, Ontario, Yukon Territory, and then internationally into Montana, into Alaska, into Russia, and recently this year in April it was the 87 plains bison that were moved to the Blackfeet Nation in Montana. So if I circle back, in 100 years, we provided 2,500 plains and wood bison around the world.
You just mentioned about transferring bison from Elk Island to the Blackfeet Reserve in Montana. That was last April. Tasha was with us as a film producer. I've introduced that she's really interested in the relation between indigenous people and the buffalo. And she brought with us something that's very special. I think it's, what, the second showing? Maybe second showing only of that transfer and a piece of her short film. So Tasha, can you, before we look at the clip, at the movie, can you tell us a little bit more what it means for you and how this relationship between First Nation and National Park came together for you as an experience?
I was a graduate student at the University of Calgary, and there was a call out for projects to talk about Alberta's history. And because I was doing buffalo research and actually looking at the Pablo Allard herd and mapping out where it had been and thinking about notions of like exile from the land and diaspora and all of these academic things, I thought, gee, maybe I can put something forward to make a film about the herd. And because I had always worked in narrative documentary, I wanted to challenge myself and make something that told a story without words. So I made a short animation with the help of the Banff Center that was a mix of animation and video called Buffalo Calling. It's a 12-minute film that shows the movement of the herd and its eventual release back, not quite home, but Grasslands National Park stood in for its return to that particular ecosystem. I too want to acknowledge Wes and his role in that and in taking me out over a couple of summers to follow that herd and film it. I decided after that I wanted to make a feature documentary or longer form film that really goes in depth in these stories of indigenous people, exactly what we've been talking about, imagining the buffalo coming back and making that happen and the different ways that, and the different partnerships and the different challenges that different indigenous peoples have that have this important relationship to the buffalo. One of the stories that I started to work with the help of Leroy, Little Bear, and Amethyst First Rider was the transfer of these 87 buffalo, these Pablo Allard buffalo, as they're called, or the Latitiche buffalo, or whatever. But they're going back to where the calves first came from, which is in Blackfeet territory in Montana. And so I started visiting the people there and establishing a relationship with them, and ultimately was able to film the transfer. So what I have tonight is the raw footage. I've edited it a little bit and I've put some music under, but it's just a piece of the hopefully for the longer. And it's one of the stories that I'm following of indigenous people and bringing buffalo back to the land. So that's what we have here tonight.
the beginning, we wanted to bring some adult animals so we could start the breeding program right away, but those animals left home as, you know, as calves. And I was standing there, and it just kind of came over me that they just made it happen that they're coming back home as calves, too.
Absolutely. I think one of the greatest moments is the whole part of us coming together, non-Native and Indigenous people. I think that's a really big aspect of it and a big teaching for all of us.
It's a lot about connecting two countries, connecting two cultures, yeah. Connecting youth to their cultural heritage, connecting these buffalo back to their ancient homelands and the original people who cared for them. So.
You might not have the chance to be there when they come back to Banff, but this is a little glimpse of the power of bringing back buffalo.
And I just want to say how much joy was in the community, and you can see some of it when they, you know, all the people had been waiting and it was cold and there were delays in bringing them, and the kids and the elders and all, they just were, you know, so happy. It's meant a lot to the community to have these particular animals back, to have a part of their history back. They're doing really well, and they're happy. They're going to play an important role for the Blackfeet in Montana because they're going to be protectors of sacred space and sacred land. So much Indigenous territory is under threat from resource extraction. The Blackfeet are no exception, and these animals are eventually going to occupy a space to protect a very sacred place for the Blackfeet. And so this is part of that relationship that, you know, goes so far beyond just what you're told in your history books. You know, this is an ongoing and lived relationship. One of the things that I love about the power of film is to bring those sorts of connections to people. And so my hope is to continue to be able to be invited to film these sorts of stories and eventually put it together into a longer film.
Leroy he's been spiriting the Buffalo Treaty, and we've mentioned it a few times, and I will give the platform to Leroy to talk about why are we bringing the nations together under the Buffalo Treaty? Why is it that Buffalo, but what is that new paradigm that we're trying to talk about that the Buffalo is teaching us if we start to listen where we could go? And I don't think there's a better person than Leroy to bring you in that story.
We've told this short, succinct history and story about the what led up to the Buffalo Treaty. On the Blood Indian Reserve, probably about 2008, 2009, our elders, brought together by one of our grad students at the time, with the elders, which was the beginning of many dialogues with the elders all over Blackfoot country on both sides of the international border. The gist of all those dialogues, it seemed that our elders were kind of, if I could say, testing the sincerity of the younger generation in terms of talking about Buffalo restoration, because that's what those dialogues were about. In those dialogues, we sat around tables and so on, around tables and et cetera, and we would always have an empty chair for the Buffalo spirit. After about 6-7 years of these dialogues, the elders finally came together and they said, okay, I think we are all of one mind that we want to bring the Buffalo back. For those reasons that some of the panelists have already, you know, stated, cultural reasons, you know, economic reasons, religious beliefs, and so on. They basically said, the job is a really big job to do. In other words, this whole notion about Buffalo restoration, I don't know that we alone can bring back the Buffalo just on our own. We need to seek partnerships. We need to bring friends together. As was the case when we started these dialogues, we thought we were the only ones talking Buffalo restoration. But in a very quick fashion, we started to come across people, NGOs that were interested in and talking the same thing. We ran across Bison Belong. We heard about Banff National Park wanting to bring the Buffalo back. We ran into Wes Olson, you know, who we now refer to as our Buffalo Grandpa. The word spread very quickly through the Moccasin Telegraph, not through the iPhone, with our neighboring tribes and so on, as a result of all that, you know, similar-mindedness, that a treaty was the elders' way of bringing people to into a partnership with regard to buffalo restoration. The treaty itself was signed on September the 23rd, 2014. And the buffalo was being used as keystone, as the portal to bring in cooperation amongst all the signatories to work together on things like conservation, the environment, education, health, research, and economics. That's what the treaty speaks to. I see there's a copy out front. Some of you may have cruised through some of the content of the treaty. But the treaty itself, as we said, soon spread amongst our neighboring First Nations. Three of the Nakota First Nations signed on to the treaty. From Muscogee's, the Samson Band signed on. A year later or so, the nine of the treaty four nations in Saskatchewan also signed on. During a different, slightly different type of a gathering, as you know, amongst North and South American indigenous people, there's these stories and prophecies that speak to the getting together of the people of the Condor, representing the southern indigenous people, and the people of the Eagle, representing the indigenous people of the North America. There was one of these Condor and Eagle meetings in New York this past summer. One of our elders said, I'm going to take a copy of this treaty to this meeting in New York. And he was an elder from the Treaty 4 area in Saskatchewan. And he did. Well, guess what? He comes back with signatures to the treaty from all of our brothers and sister nations from Central and South America, so that today we have probably 50 signatories to the Buffalo Treaty. That's quite an accomplishment and something to celebrate, and I think this is at a International Mountain Day, I think it's very appropriate to celebrate such an accomplishment. One of the things that has come out of this treaty is that we as humans have, talking about paradigms, we have to start really rethinking those paradigms that we operate by on a daily basis. Most of us, every morning, simply wake up and do the same old. And we never question the foundational basis upon which our actions, our beliefs, our relationships, and so on. What are the foundational basis to those? Well, if you did a little bit of historical research, you will find that a large part of those foundational basis were from 400, 500, 600 years ago, based on what is known as the Enlightenment era, or the Age of Reason. The foundations that we operate by today are all based on that. And our institutions teach those very things. I think some of those beliefs and foundations that we operate by based on this age of reason, I think are getting a little bit dated and don't always answer our needs and so forth. Things like this buffalo restoration are causes for rethinking those paradigms upon which we operate on a daily basis. You know, we don't want to be scaring people and, you know, and so forth, but for every animal that disappears, hey, I think we become a little less human. There's going to be a time that when we as a species inhabiting this earth might also disappear into the darkness. And those are the kind of things it seems that our elders were thinking about when they were talking buffalo restoration. Because the things that this animal does for us is make for our long-term survival.
So you probably realize that we're talking about bringing bison back to Banff National Park, but we're talking much more than that. It wouldn't be any better place than this first mountain festival organized by the Canadian Mountain Network on the International Mountain Day to all of us together climb the nicest mountain that we have in our backyard, make them even better. So Karsten, in your presentation, there was a little one line, inspiring Canadian, volunteering 24/7. I want to get us a little bit back. I'm getting on the concrete. What does it mean? How do Canadian, anyone here or their family, if they want to see the bison, we've mentioned they're in the back country, 2 days. Believe me, we went on a backpack. It took us 9 days back and forth. There's no bridges on any of those rivers. Better get ready to ford, so spring is a pretty hard one. How do you get those Canadian to volunteer to be there? What's the opportunities? And I would like if you could explain a little bit more. I'll bring it to Bill at the end. Bill, this journey of cooperation with Banff National Park, what does that mean? And you might not know, but on the Stoney Reserve, they have over 200 bison. And that was a big surprise to quite a few people in the Bow Valley. So I want to bring those two together before we open the floor to questions. Karsten?
The project goes through a number of phases. And for instance, last summer, we did have some volunteers come and help us build the pasture fence where the bison will first be held for the first 16 months. And those people were all tired by the end, but also it was great. They were invigorated, and I think a lot of Canadians want to be a part of this. Understandably, it's a historic project. It's a historic moment. We're going to be soliciting volunteers in the next month or so for helping us out in the soft release pasture phase. And we're targeting particularly people who have animal husbandry experience. In the future, there will be other phases where we won't be seeking animal husbandry experience per se. We'll be seeking other levels of experience. But if you do feel you have some animal husbandry experience that would be beneficial for this project, please do reach out to me. Easiest way to do that is to Google Banff National Park Bison Reintroduction, and then at the bottom of that web page comes up my name and my contacts. But yeah, absolutely, people on the ground helping us in the everyday tasks is a huge part of the project.
And for the people who won't be able to go there, how can we even follow or see anything of the next future steps?
One of the challenges of the project is to bring the event, and Tasha did a great job of bringing you the event of the bison being reintroduced to the Blackfeet Nation. One of the challenges is for us to do that for all Canadians who can't be there. So that's something we're going to be doing through some filmmaking, some video journals of the people who are actually caring for the bison initially. The other thing is, if you want to make the trek back there, by all means, it's a pretty special place. One thing we're doing very closely in the project is to guard that wilderness value. It's one of the few places left in that part of the world that doesn't have road access. So you arrive in that place where bison were being reintroduced, somewhat a different person than he might have left the trailhead. There is no iPhone connectivity or anything like that. It's a place where you can reconnect not only with the land and with bison, but quite frankly, with yourself as well.
And Bill, I think you can add a little bit of the experience too of working closely with Banff National Park. You mentioned it quite at the beginning of the ceremonies and what you brought over the last summer. Can you just elaborate more on when you say with the ceremonies, what do you mean? What did happen in that new collaboration or that renewed collaboration?
We were able to involve Banff Parks in many of our ceremonies and our Buffalo Treaty signing going back to August of 2015. And also our bison reintroduction ceremony 2016. Just recently, we were able to invite Parks Canada staff out to the buffalo paddock out at Stoney. We've had a buffalo herd there since the early 70s. When self-government first came about for many of the bands, it allowed for some greater controls around resources within reserves. And one of the first things that our people did was to make way, make land, and make space available for buffaloes to return to the reserve. We've had them there, and that's why we wanted Parks to come out and see some of the management practices that we follow for the herd that we've had since early 70s. And I think it'll help park staff in that they'll be able to see how buffalo have been maintained in an environment that's very, very close to the mountain environments that are very much the what they'll experience in the Panther Dorma era. And just to touch on one other point, reason why we wanted to include Bison Belong in with Canadian Mountain Festival, I think is best summed up in the ceremony that we did for the Buffalo Treaty in 2015. Manerpa, the waterfalls at Cascade Mountain, is one of our sacred places for Stoney, and that's why we chose that location in association with working with Parks Canada to do our Buffalo Treaty signing. It's a very nice way to join the bison restoration, also with parks, with mountain places, and the importance of a place that is different between Western science and traditional knowledge. The meaning of place is very much important, is a fixed place in traditional knowledge. And so it's very nice to be able to come here and share this knowledge with everyone, and just to give a little bit of background around our involvement in assisting with parks and the reintroduction.
So we've been talking Ini, Pascomasis. We've been talking about Tatanka. We've been thinking bison, buffalo, same in French, I'm not going to keep going there. We've been talking about Kwekwe. This is all the bison. So we want to hear now from your side, if you have any question that you would like to, one, all of them as a specific.
This one's for Karsten. I was wondering when you were doing your presentation, I guess the end game of the reintroduction, how much of the park do you want to cover with bison territory, or how many animals do you want in the park? And do you see transferring it or expanding that territory even to the bordering national parks around Banff?
The honest answer is we don't know yet. And I don't mean that in that we're just going to start something that there's no plan for. I mean it in the perspective of we're dealing with an animal that's been gone for 140 years. And it's a big part of why we've phased the project and just haven't committed to full-scale restoration off the get-go. We have a lot of learning to do. We've developed predictive models of where the bison might go. We've assessed, you know, we've incorporated archaeological evidence and traditional knowledge. We don't know how well it's going to go. We don't know if they're going to try and leave. All those things are unknown questions. A lot of this project is going to be up to the animals themselves, and I think sort of making the place as welcoming and fertile as possible, both from a spiritual perspective in terms of some of the ceremonial aspects, but also from a biological perspective has been one of our priorities. But we have a number of different measures by which we'll assess that five-year trial. And there's also all these things that are kind of changing as we're going as well, and the political landscape may be completely different in 5 years than it is now. There could be the possibility of co-managing a herd that is transboundary both in and outside of the national park. Jasper did try a reintroduction with wood bison back in the 70s. We were taking a lot of the lessons learned from that and trying to do it differently to avoid some of the mistakes they made. In terms of, are we envisioning the bison going all the way up to Jasper eventually someday? At this point, we're not actually looking that far ahead. Even the numbers were, I talked about if we could proceed beyond 5 years, we would go to developing a management plan that would, amongst other things, set population targets. Yeah, if that sounds a little wishy-washy, it's actually a calculated wishy-washiness.
We need to big bison and wildlife in Alberta. It's pretty simple. Saskatchewan did it 10 years ago. Did not only a livestock, that's our last like mental fences that we've put in our brain. We not only put the bison behind fences ever since they went to near massive extensions, which we did to the First Nation, but we're not even allowing them to be who they are. So as a French-Canadian, Alberta, I would say that's the next like jump that we need to do. We need to make bison, and this is like not that hard to imagine. And bringing bison to Banff is just, but it's always been the chicken and the eggs. Do you make the policy change in Alberta, or do you work with the federal government to do it? Once we have the hoofs on the grounds, which are coming in a few weeks, that's what we're sharing with you, can we make the next steps? Can we all be part of it? We're really that close to, because once we do that, I mean, we haven't even tell you what, like, they brought back to the Blackfeet. These are our First Nation, but this fence, this mental barrier, they are not wildlife, and they're not wildlife because the Wildlife and Fish and Management Act was written, guess which year? Right after the extension of the bison in Alberta. This is about us changing it. So I'm like, that's my advocacy hat that he cannot do. But seriously, if we want to help and move, this is one of the only species that we are not allowing to be free. And we need to move that. And I really congratulate Parks Canada and the federal governments to make the steps to make it in Banff, because we need those examples. And not just for the animals, it's for all of us in our own spirit, because this has been holding us back. So to that, I'll move to the next question.
I grew up in the southeast corner of Saskatchewan. There was a creek through the pasture that went through my grandfather's farm and my parents' farm. There was unbroken land beside it. And there I saw how things work together, how the creatures and the insects and the flowers were one with the creek. Recently that I went with a cousin to visit my grandfather's former farm and discovered buffalo wallows. And the grass there was different. It was spiky. It was up to my knees. And cattle were being grazed there and horses. There was a sense of wholeness in that land that is a touchstone for me. And I'm wondering for anyone with respect to speak about the importance of the buffalo wallows.
So I'll break the rules and I'll call someone in the audience here. Wes Halson, Buffalo Grandpa.
Thank you very much. I spent 25 years in Elk Island National Park managing the bison herd there. Took the herd that's in grasslands down there, I took them to Russia. In all those places, it's been my preoccupation trying to understand how bison affect the landscape. And bison wallows are one of the most profound. In Grasslands National Park, for example, you can walk across that landscape that hasn't had a bison on it since the 1870s, and it's pockmarked with bison wallows. And every one of those wallows is providing a very unique contribution to the ecosystem. We watched pronghorn antelopes, for example, give birth in a bison wallow on a really cold, blustery day, and they were sheltered and warm because of that little depression. Bison wallows fill up with water in the spring, and the Canadian toad, the Great Plains toad, leopard frogs, they all have evolved to lay their eggs in there and metamorphose in a matter of 10 days, and they're back out on the prairie. So bison wallows have a huge impact on the landscape, right from insects all the way up to pronghorns.
Thank you, Wes. Everyone knows what we're talking about, the wallows? bison have two beautiful horns, and they kind of scratch themselves on the ground. And as they scratch, and they need some, like, of that dirt to make sure that the ticks and other insects doesn't get to their fur and skin, they kind of create those beautiful little wallows, those holes that are very magical and special places. So those are them, and you can still see them in Banff National Park. You see them around the landscape, those beautiful holding space that it's been holding over 140 years, 150 years of without the bison, they still hold this special magic, and that's what she was talking about.
This is also from the presentation. I know you talked a lot about the importance of them bonding to their new home and having like calves coming in to help with that, what the consequences would be if that doesn't happen, and what kind of signs you would see if that wasn't happening, and then also if there's any sort of intervention that could be done to support that kind of midway through.
I think some of the intervening signs might be that they want to leave the soft release pasture, and they actually will have a chance to expand out into a secondary pasture in the first summer. Everything we've heard and learned from others, and we've been doing a lot of conferring with others during the course of our planning, is that, you know, so long as their basic needs are met, particularly in food, then they don't have a lot of motivation to leave per se. And then obviously if they're not bothered by anything, so we're going to be careful not to get them used to us and to always deal with them in the same way. One of the neat things about the project eventually is that this is going to be one of the few populations of plains bison in North America that are actually exposed to all their natural predators, you know, wolves, cougars, grizzly bears, and scavengers, you know, like wolverine and so on. Our intent is during that captive phase of holding them and having them calve a couple times that they'll have a little bit of a refuge from that as well as before they get started of being a little bit wilder. Any things we might be able to do, we might be able to, for instance, maybe burn a little bit of their summer pasture to provide that succulent growth if it seems like in its current state it isn't good enough for them. And we might be able to adjust the feed if the original feed that we're going to be having for them is deemed inadequate. But beyond that, I think we really are going with the best expert advice in terms of what we're going to do in preparations.
I'm just kind of wondering how things are in your discussions with the province about the change of, or possible change in status. Is it moving in a positive direction, or...?
I think there's some encouraging signs. The day after the American Bison Society meeting in Banff, the province announced a process to review the status of the bison in the province. And I think that's really exciting. We have this anomaly of the one native species in the province that, you know, isn't even considered an animal. The logic of that is important, but from the point of view of, you know, the what you can do thing sitting in the audience, is talking about bison being classified as wildlife in the province would be a really valuable thing for you to talk up over your Christmas dinners and New Year's parties and Hanukkah candle lightings and everything else. It's an important thing for us to talk about as who we are. Do we want this? So I'm hopeful. We don't have an outcome yet.
In this whole issue about buffalo restoration, we want to thank all of the NGOs and individuals and so on that are involved in it. And you see our buffalo people over here, if I can call it that. I don't know if many of you know that a whole nation has taken on the notion of buffalo restoration, and that is the United States. Less than a year ago, the United States declared the bison as their national mammal. So in other words, a whole country has taken on the notion of buffalo restoration. In other words, realizing this very key role that this animal plays in the overall environment and ecology of our lands. Here in Alberta, there is no special protection, any mention of the bison, the buffalo, in law and so on. It's almost like it's there, but nobody pays attention. Yes, through organizations and so on, as part of this treaty, Buffalo Treaty, we've been knocking on the government's doors, the environment people, the Ministry of Environment and Parks, trying to get them to think of reclassifying the buffalo from domestic to wild. If they did that, it would give an opportunity to this animal to really assist us. We're talking climate change. We're talking about environmental protection. But as our elders said, we can't do it alone. We need partnerships. Well, in this case, it would be a partnership with the very animal itself. You could find no better environmentalist than the buffalo.
In along with the classification of changing buffalo to wildlife, we are also hopeful for changing place names. One of the outcomes of the Buffalo Treaty meeting in Banff this past September was to advocate federal and provincial governments towards the changing of Tunnel Mountain. And the ceremony that we went through in order to come up with that name was Yarhe Tatanga Wawiage Wakan, which translates as Sacred Buffalo Guardian Mountain. That has more meaning than the current name of Tunnel Mountain, for which there is no tunnel at Tunnel Mountain. And so we are hopeful of the name change, just as we are hopeful of the status of the wildlife change.
Thank you. I think that's really great, because what a better place than being a mountain festival to talk about changing name of a mountain. The one that's sitting right in the middle of the Bow Valley, that if you're in Banff, you're looking at that little hump, but it's not a hump. Actually, is the guardian. He's looking after all of us in the sacred places that are gathering. And this is what we're talking about, bringing those animals to Banff National Park, that we hope that we share with you. A little bit of our excitement that's coming in a few weeks, a little bit of our dream. And it's not only Banff. Banff is a piece of something that's much bigger in our inner self, but it's much bigger in our relationship of where we can be. In Alberta, I mean, let's be honest, like bisons are wildlife in BC and Saskatchewan, but not in this province. And let's keep dreaming.